This is the linear amplifier I made to use with my homemade transceiver. It is for 50 MHz, 2.5 watt input, 25 watt outputs, with DC 24 volts. As you can see, I used a cabinet that was from, I think, a modem or so, and I added the connector for the in and output and the heat sink, and I will make it open, remove some screws so you can see how it is inside. After removing some screws, sometimes even the correct one, it is possible to slide off the cover that I cut a piece out, and what we have is this amplifier. The voltage is coming via a D connector, and it is rather straightforward. I have a fuse in it, a relay, and some bias voltage. And as you can see, the hole in the middle was originally made for a transistor. I made a circuit with a transistor. I don't know what kind of transistor it was, but when it broke down, I had to find a substitute, and I changed the schematic to use with an RF 510 MOSFET. And you see the input circuit and the output circuit, the relay, and a filter. I will explain the schematic. In fact, there are two schematics, one for the switching part and one for the RF part. This is the switching part. As you maybe can remember, some DC is added in the transceiver on the antenna socket, and that DC voltage is blocked here and went via this coil, and is the RF is taken away to the transistor, to the bias of transistor, via these two resistors. If you don't add voltage here, the resistor is closed, and when you add some voltage here, it is open, and it means the relay is activated, and if it is activated, it switches the amplifier in this line, and if it is not activated, it is straightforward, and we do have a low pass filter at the end that's used during receive and transmit. If you don't have voltage on this amplifier, everything goes straightforward, so no problem then. The voltage for this transistor is coming from a touch regulator and a 33 ohms resistor that takes also a part of the dissipation, divided now between those two elements. Then we go now to the RF part, so to this part of the schematic. And this is the RF part of the circuit. The DC is blocked, it's going to the other circuit, and I had some fixed values of capacitors here in parallel. By trial and error, it would have been better if I used a trimmer for it. In here I have a small coil, and then the power is going to this resistor of 10 ohm, 2 watts, and the voltage is swinging the gate of this MOSFET. We have also some DC on the gate via this resistors, and I made some filtering here to ensure that this is a really clear, clean voltage here. And this 12 volt is coming from that voltage regulator in the DC part of the circuit. Here we have a coil of 16 turns that I put a core in it. It is to as an RF choke with some capacitors, and then I added a toroid coil also to get rid of everything what is RF, and via fuse that is new for me, fuse in it, going to the 24 volt DC. The sources on the ground, and the drain has also here, of course, the RF output, a coil, two trimmers, and then going to the relay. And from the relay we go to a low pass filter. It is some different than the other low pass filters that has only one coil and two capacitors, and in this case we have also a capacitor here, so this forms a blocking frequency for the second harmonic. You can try with LC what shape it is. It is really a dip on this frequency. The power supply looks a bit strange. Originally it is intended to be used to be slid over a motor of a high-low home care bed. So therefore it has more outputs. And it says it is 120 watts IPX4 24 volts. There's a very rigid cable to it and a strange connector with a green button. There's a relay in it. Normally this cable is without voltage unless you operate the bed, and then the relay is operated and then the AC mains voltage passed through this cable. So I opened this connector. You have to unscrew it and then with a rubber hammer or so just smash it once, and then it opens, and then you can make it short circuit the relay. We don't use this relay system. Inside is a transformer and some diodes as a rectifier bridge and a large capacitor. And I only used that as a power supply, so it is not stabilized or so. That's stable enough, and I connected it to this output and to a deconnector that I use. So that's the way my power supply for the amplifier is organized. I connected the amplifier to the transceiver, and the antenna connection via a power attenuator and some more attenuations. So this is 20 dB, 10 dB and 20 dB. So it makes 50 dB in total, and I connect it to my spectrum analyzer. You can see with the spectrum analyzer that if I whistle, what will be the major carrier, that's the left one, and the second one that I put the marker on gives the second harmonic. So this is a span from 10 MHz to 160 MHz, and the first one is 50 MHz. And the second one, and you can see in the top display, that it is about minus 48 dB down compared to the wanted signal. The third harmonic, however, it could be hardly noticed, so it's at least more than 60 dB down. Let's hook it up to the milliwatt meter. Now I connected the head of the milliwatt meter of HP to this combination of attenuators and the amplifier. And when I switch the microphone in, and whistle, you see immediately that it is again full scale. It is the same as with the other movie, with the only the transceiver, 0.3 milliwatt, full scale. Hello, hello, hello. And I have now 10 dB more attenuation than I had with only the transceiver measured, meaning we have 10 dB more output power. So with 3 watts of input with this amplifier, we have 0 watt output, 10 dB more is 10 times, so this is 30 watts output from this IRF 510. The heatsink will not really heat up. I can talk all day, and even with digital modes, it warms up a bit, but it will not really heat up. So that's the amplifier.